I'd like to begin this evening by asking each of our guests, starting with you, Mark. We've decided to be very informal. Hopefully it will be like you're sitting in a living room and hearing our conversations here. Starting with you, asking you to tell us a little bit about yourself, who you are, what your worldview is, and why you think conversations about science and religion are important.
Thank you. I'm very happy to be here. I'd like to thank Rod Pulse for inviting me, and I'd like to thank Veritas for organizing the whole thing and the volunteers for putting it together, and I'd like to thank you all for coming. And I really hope that we can contribute to one another's understanding. And I have to make a confession. I'm a little bit out of my comfort zone. I'm a scientist. I've never spoken to a group about anything but science before. And I've never spoken without a PowerPoint presentation before. And so normally I can turn around and look at the screen and it reminds me of what I'm going to say next, but when I turn around and look at the screen, I see myself, which doesn't help a lot with my comfort level. And finally, I grew up in a family and a culture that kind of considered it to be a little unseemly to talk about religion in front of people I don't know. I've never really done that before, and there's a lot of people here I don't know. I do see people I know. So I'll pretend like I'm just talking to them. So and that's partly why I have the cheat sheet here, because I don't have the PowerPoint. So I was asked to talk about myself by talking about my worldview. I grew up in a Christian family. I went to church every Sunday from when I was a little kid up through high school, most of the way through high school. My dad was a church volunteer. He was in the choir. My mom taught summer Bible school. We are Methodists, which is a mainline Protestant denomination. In fact, it's the biggest one. We were anything but evangelicals. There wasn't a lot of God talk in our house. We went to church Sunday mornings. My dad said grace. My grandfather said grace. But we were really taught that Christianity was about behavior. It wasn't so much about belief. In fact, it wasn't before I went to college. I'd never had anybody ask me if I accepted Jesus Christ as my personal savior. The answer was no. I had never heard the question. For me, Christianity was entirely about behavior. So my parents modeled that behavior. My grandparents modeled that behavior. We were kind of upper Midwest, hardworking, stoic, humble people. That's the stock that I descended from. My paternal grandfather was a devout Christian, went to church every Sunday, didn't talk about it a lot, but observed. In fact, my mom told me that when she was a kid, he remembered the Sabbath day and kept it holy. That's one of the Ten Commandments that I don't think too many people observe anymore. But he was a farmer, and even on days where it was a nice sunny day, they could have been harvesting or something, and a storm might have been moving in, he did not, he did not work. And I do think that there are valid reasons for having a day off once a week. You bond with your family, you bond with your community. There are perfectly good reasons to do that you don't have to believe in God or Jesus to accept. So that's what I descended from, that's what I was taught. So when we were kids and we misbehaved, got caught telling a lie, or if I was particularly mean to my sister, what my mom would say is, "Aren't you a Christian?" That was like the worst thing she could say. If it was really bad, I might get sent to my room to think about whether or not I was a Christian. So Christianity was about behavior. And I think when you're really young, the synapses in your brain, the linguistic words actually connect. Words that have similar meaning occupy a similar part of your brain. I grew up near Boulder, Colorado, in what was then a small town called Broomfield. The mountains were to the west. I learned very quickly that mountains were west. West, mountains, west. Those two words are really closely linked in my brain. Now I live in Albuquerque. I've lived here for 33 years. I live in the Sandia foothills. I look out to the west, I mean east, and I see the Sandias, the biggest Sandia front, but I still think mountains west are linked in my brain. And for the same reason, Christian and good are linked in my brain. And so I tend to get defensive around my atheist friends, some of my atheist friends, they don't all do it, when they bash Christians. Although, you know, I'm not above making fun of certain Christian beliefs. For example, creationism. The most famous thing I ever wrote is not a scientific paper, it is a joke. It was an April Fool's joke almost 20 years ago where I mapped the creationism controversy in New Mexico when the school board wanted to teach creationism, and I mapped it onto teaching that the value, mathematical value of pi was exactly 3 because that comes from the Bible. And that was widely circulated. I wrote it for a little newsletter of a group called New Mexicans for Science and Reason. It was on the front page on April 1st. I thought I'd put in all the clues that everybody would get the joke, but our leader, Dave Thomas, took it upon himself to post it in a news group, I think Talk Evolution or one of those, and it took off. I was making fun of the controversy. I wasn't necessarily making fun of specific people, but I'm not completely above that. We didn't have a lot of religious instruction at home. We did have a family, a children's Bible, and I remember sitting on my mom's lap, and she would, you know, flip the pages, and I would look at the pictures, and I remember distinctly the picture of Abraham standing over Isaac and God telling him, you know, you've got to sacrifice your son, and it was very disturbing to me. And my mom, who was a summer Bible school teacher, said, well, you know, we don't really believe in that God. We don't believe in a God of fear and violence. We believe in a God of love. And so that's what I learned. And so basically, we skipped over the rest of the Old Testament. but that said, we had that book in our house. We had other picture books as well, National Geographic. And I remember more distinctly sitting on my dad's lap looking at pictures of National Geographic. We had a Time Life volume called The World We Live In. And I would study that literally for hours before I could even read, with pictures of the way the Earth formed, the way animals evolved, ecosystems, the Arctic rainforest, the fish that live in the deep part of the ocean. And that really, really sparked my curiosity. And I think that's what led to me being a scientist. And I think my time is up.
Thank you very much. Dr. Lennox, would you tell us a little bit about yourself and your worldview?
Thank you very much for inviting me to this city. I didn't realize before I accepted the invitation that it was so near to heaven. And I gather one has to get used to these immense altitudes. So if I sound as if I'm drowning in lack of oxygen, you will understand what's going on. Mark said he was out of his comfort zone, but really it's me that's out of my comfort zone, because he's a real scientist. The laboratories at which he works are absolutely world famous, and I've heard of them since my childhood. He also studied in Caltech with luminaries like Richard Feynman. So I'm just a pure mathematician engaged in algebra, and that would bore most people to tears. And I'm so grateful, Mark, for your sharing your background. It's very interesting to compare these things. My parents were Christian, and so were my grandparents, and so were my great-grandparents in Ireland. Ireland was in those days a very sectarian country. And very unusually, my parents were Christian without being sectarian. Now, what did that mean? My father had a small business in a small town, employed maximally 40 people. But because he believed sincerely that all human beings are made in the image of God, no matter what they believe, he employed equally across the religious divide, Catholics and Protestants. That cost us a few bonds. from the terrorists. So we knew what that meant. Secondly, which is very unusual, even more unusual, my parents not only allowed me to think, but encouraged me to think. And Christianity for me, and I was fascinated by your emphasis on behavior, it was certainly an emphasis on behavior, but before that it was an emphasis on truth. And my father never got to university, nor did my mum, but they wanted me to think hard about this matter of worldview. And I recall once, I think I was 13, my father handed me a book. I said, "What's that, Dad?" He says, "It's the Communist Manifesto." I said, "Should I read it?" Well, he said, "You need to know what other people think." So I was brought up in a very unusually open intellectual atmosphere, and the key thing was truth. Was this true? I could see, as you saw in my parents, a living paradigm that Christianity was real for them. But they loved me enough not to force it down my throat. So I was allowed to make decisions and read, and I was encouraged to read very widely. I didn't realize you were on the staff of the Skeptical Inquirer. Well, I'm a great skeptic. You may not have known that. But the Greek word skeptai means to check out from a distance. And if we don't check things out from a distance, then we're rather silly people. So I'm an extreme skeptic in that sense. Check things out. And that's what I was encouraged to do from the beginning. And I suppose the biggest worldview question is, what is the nature of ultimate reality? What's the really real? And here's where the academy today divides essentially into two, certainly in Oxford. There are those who believe, like me, that there is a God who created and upholds the universe, so that the ultimate reality is God. There are others, like Stephen Hawking, who believe the ultimate reality is nothing. And I mean that seriously, that nothing creates the universe. So we have this curious polarity that ultimate reality, God, ultimate reality, nothing. And we can discuss that if we wish to. Of course, there are stages in between, mass, energy, quantum vacuum, and so on and so forth. But what I'd like to suggest is our answer to that question determines all the answers to the other questions. The significance of human life. I just mentioned my father believing that all men and women, no matter what they believe, and that's a crucial thing, are made in the image of God and therefore are of infinite value. And that has stuck with me all of my life because I saw it practiced as giving human beings an infinite value as made in the image of God. I find it difficult to see where such values come from in the absence of God, which may well be one of the things that we shall discuss. I went to Cambridge, and there I had an experience that really changed things, in a sense that a student about a week in said to me, "Do you believe in God?" And he says, "Oh, I'm sorry, you're Irish." I should never have asked you that question. All you Irish believe in God, and you fight about it. Well, of course I'd heard that before, but seriously today, the late Christopher Hitchens, with whom I debated, that was his biggest objection to religion. It's the cause of so much damage and so on. That really made me think. And so I decided, just to explain where I'm coming from, because this set the course for my life. I decided on that day in Cambridge that I would get to know as many people as possible who did not share my worldview. Now you see, in Ireland we had atheists, Protestant atheists or Catholic atheists, but there were scarcely any real ones. And I looked round, and there was a man who was an agnostic, and so he'd never been to church, and his parents had never been to church. And so that dialogue started, and I've been doing it ever since. My interest in atheism led me to Eastern Europe during the Cold War, particularly to East Germany, because I was interested in what this worldview would do to people. And when the wall fell, I started going to Russia because I happened to speak the language, and so I was able to dialogue with many people in the academies of science about these things. So passionately interested I am in science, because I very rapidly learned that far from science and belief in God being in opposition to one another, It was actually faith in an intelligent creator that drove science upwards in the 16th and 17th centuries. What I find odd today is that Isaac Newton believed in God and used the law of gravity as evidence. Stephen Hawking doesn't believe in God and uses the law of gravity as evidence. Now, we might want to tease that out later. But what I discovered is there's a huge intellectual fog, ladies and gentlemen, where people like Hawking ask us to choose between science and God. And what I discovered was there are two main reasons for that. The one is a false concept of God. And many people today, when I use the word God, they're thinking of a Greek god of the gaps. I can't explain it, therefore God did it. Now, if you define God like that, of course you have to choose between science and God, because that's the way you've defined God. Let me make it absolutely clear that the God I believe in is the God who created the whole show, the bits we understand and the bits we don't. And that's why, of course, advance in science doesn't get rid of God. The other reason is, and this is a hugely interesting topic to me, the nature of explanation. What do we mean by saying science explains? Let me give you just one single example, because we can pick these things up. God is no more in competition with science as explanation for the universe than Henry Ford is in competition with the law of internal combustion as an explanation for a motor car. There are different levels of explanation. And one of the problems in the contemporary debate is we've opened ourselves to what we call scientism, the idea that science is the only way to truth. Science is powerful because it's limited in the questions it asks. So there's a huge debate to be held here. And the final point in connection with the title is, the other thing I was taught as a child was, I don't own this planet. There is an owner, and therefore the way I treat it and the environment is a very serious matter indeed. Thank you.
I'd like to turn now to the question of evidence, which obviously is pertinent to one's worldview, and raise the question of what kinds of evidence and what other considerations, if any, should be relevant to the question of whether one should believe that God exists. And to put this in a local context here in New Mexico, I suspect both of you know that this was the setting of the movie Contact, based on Carl Sagan's novel about the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. And the most dramatic moment in that movie is when the message comes across a very large array that's a series of prime numbers, and Jodie Foster's playing the role of the heroine in the movie immediately recognizes, well, this is obviously came from an intelligent source. And so the question, the way I'd like to frame the question of evidence is, do you believe that there's evidence in the world that, like a sequence of prime numbers, is best explained as coming from an intelligent source? And let me ask you to begin on this one.
I enjoyed Carl Sagan's book. What he didn't say in his book was, do you know what the best evidence for extraterrestrial intelligence is? That they haven't tried to contact us. But now, to be serious, Sagan's book is very interesting because he believes, as many scientists believe, that intelligent input is recognizable scientifically. And this is enormously important because, of course, when it gets to the bigger God debate, that is something that many, many people challenge. But standing on Carl Sagan's side for a moment, let me say two major things about this. Firstly, one of the main reasons I reject atheism is that we can do science. The universe is mathematically intelligible. Now, just think about that. Einstein was clever enough to see that that created a problem. He says the only incomprehensible thing about the universe is that it's comprehensible. And faith, and I use the word advisably, faith in the rational intelligibility of the universe is the essence of science. You don't do science if you don't believe that science can be done. And to cut a long story short, sometimes I have fun with my colleagues. I say, what do you do science with? And they say, well, I've got a $1 billion accelerator. No, I don't mean that. I mean, oh, you mean, and they're about to say mind when they remember there's no such thing as the mind. And they say, my brain. I say, that'll do for a minute. I do believe that there is a mind. tell me about this instrument you do science with. What is it? Well, do you want the short story? Yes, please. Well, the short story is, the brain is the end product of a mindless, unguided process. And I look at them and say, and you trust it. The first person to raise that objection was Charles Darwin, who said, I sometimes have this horrible doubt that the mind, which I believe has come from below, how could we possibly trust it? After all, who would trust the convictions in a monkey's mind if there were convictions in such a mind? Now, this argument has begun to come into the mainstream philosophy, and it's very important indeed. C.S. Lewis in the 1940s saw this. He saw, we've done brilliant science by thinking about the world. What we haven't done is think about thinking. And any view that holds that thinking is invalid cannot be true, because it's shooting itself not only in the foot, but in the brain. Alvin Plantinga is one of the world's leading philosophers, an American, and a Christian, has developed this. But far more interesting than that is Thomas Nagel's recent book, Mind and Cosmos. He's a top philosopher in New York. He's an atheist. He doesn't want there to be a God, so he's a hard atheist. But in his book, he says there's something seriously wrong with this naturalistic worldview that threatens to undermine everything. Because he says, if this evolutionary naturalism is true and we reduce all thought to physics and chemistry, we end up in a universe that's utterly meaningless. Now, the second point I want to make, if I may, is doing science means we've got a semiotic, mathematical connection between our minds and the universe. Atheism undermines that, in my view. Certainly materialism does. Secondly, in each of the 10 trillion cells of our human body, we've got a huge database. We've got the longest word ever discovered in any language, the human genome. And when I speak to the scientists that I've just been talking about, I say, tell me about the human genome. You see your own name written up here, or you see this word Veritas, immediately you know that whatever automatic processes have been involved in producing this, there's a mind behind it. Why? Because this is semiotic. These letters carry meaning. Now, the human DNA carries meaning. It codes for the proteins. And in many areas of science, of course, reductionism has been very successful. And I believe in it. But there's one area it doesn't work, and that is wherever language is involved. So what I'm suggesting, ladies and gentlemen, is really very simple. One of the biggest evidences for the existence of a cosmic intelligence, to my mind, is one, we can do science, and secondly, the science has revealed to us that our biological makeup is determined by text. Not only that, we're not only based biologically on text, we are text producers. We can produce meaningful language. And that's where I'd start in responding to that.
Thank you. Questions about what evidence should bear on the question of worldview and God's existence?
Well, I'm glad you brought up the book and the movie Contact by Carl Sagan, which is actually one of my favorite movies. The movie's a bit different than the book. The movie was really well done. In fact, I see myself in the character that Jodie Foster played, the protagonist, Ellie Arroway. And in fact, I got involved in a course at the American Film Institute for scientists to write screenplays, to try to bring science to the public and make science more interesting to the public and more realistic in movies. And that was the example I used as the movie that portrayed science and scientists more accurately than any other movie. And in that movie, the character was a skeptic. She was an atheist, and as far as I know, it's the first time Hollywood has ever portrayed an atheist in a positive light, in a very sympathetic light. But she was a skeptical about her science, too. So she had a materialist methodology and also a materialist worldview. Now, scientists have to apply a materialist methodology because that's what defines science. But they don't necessarily have to have a materialist worldview. You do not have to deny the existence of God to be a scientist. But you do have to take him out of the equation, because as soon as you put God into the equation, it's basically a cop-out. Now, there's a cartoon that any scientist in here has seen. There's a cartoonist by the name of S. Harris. And he makes fun of science and scientists. And there's a cartoon where there's a scientist or a mathematician, and he scribbled out all these equations. And then there's a step where he says, and now a miracle occurs. And then he's got a bunch of other equations, and he solves it. Well, that miracle is really not part of science. So basically, L.A. Arroway, in that movie, didn't allow for miracles and was very slow to accept the possibility that aliens, extraterrestrials, were communicating. But, you know, as the evidence came in, as the evidence increased, she came to accept that. I think the movie did a very good job sort of portraying the tension between science and religion as well. And Stephen Jay Gould wrote an essay where he says there's absolutely no overlap. He calls it noma, non-overlapping magisteria, where magisteria are realms of understanding. And he argued that there is no overlap whatsoever. I would argue that there is somewhat overlapping magisteria, soma. I guess that's a place in San Francisco. You'd call it maybe barely overlapping magisteria, boma. And I think, you know, we might want to start thinking of that overlap as kind of a demilitarized zone. You know, we've got a realm of science that's science with no religion. We've got a realm of religion with no science. And then there's this very narrow strip. Now, when you were introduced, you're an expert on the interface between science, religion, and philosophy, I think, is what Harold said. I'd like to know what you think about that.
A great deal, sir. You make several very important points, Mark, that I resonate with completely. The first thing is this God of the gaps thing that I mentioned that you briefly brought in, and of course we know all the equation of miracle occurs. The problem with that is this. If you define science to be applied materialism, as someone like Richard Lewontin does, and he says, look, our a priori conviction of materialism means that we must develop a scientific apparatus that gives us material, naturalistic answers, no matter how counterintuitive, no matter how absurd they seem. And then he's very honest and he says, we cannot allow a divine foot in the door. Now, I agree with you up to a point, and it's very difficult to explain this. You see, I'm very sensitive to the accusation. All you're doing is saying, well, I can't explain it, God did it. But there's another way of looking at that. I believe there are bad gaps and good gaps. The bad gaps are the gaps that science closes. The good ones are the gaps that science reveals. Because, you see, if there is a God behind this universe, we would expect to detect him at some level or other. And by applying a materialistic science, we might discover that instead of getting nearer to some conclusion, we're getting further away. I believe that to be the case, say, with the origin of life and the origin with any kind of information. Now, let me put it this way. Go back to Sagan. She felt the evidence was forcing her to believe that there's intelligence outside. Nowadays, somebody like Paul Davis would tell you, of course, there's intelligence outside. But it's the same kind of intelligence as ours. It's evolved from the universe. But the point I would want to make is, whenever we see language, we know an intelligence is involved. Richard Dawkins is, and this has to do with the nature of explanation. He says, look, explanation must proceed from the simple to the complex. That's what we're normally taught. It works most places, but it doesn't work with language. And I tried it out in Dawkins. I said, let's think about that. I pick up a book, The God Delusion. It's 400 pages long. It's pretty complex. I then ask for its origin. Somebody says, Richard Dawkins wrote that. It comes from his mind. I said, that can't be true, because your explanation is more complex than the thing you're explaining. That's sheer nonsense when it comes to this. Now, if you get this sequence of primes that indicates intelligence, that doesn't end science. It just means you have to allow the possibility that there's been an intelligent input into your system that you've recognized scientifically. That's the key thing. So it's no longer an intelligence of the gaps. The next question to ask is, what kind of intelligence is this? That's where it starts. Exactly analogous to discovering writing in a cave that's very ancient. You immediately see human intelligence, but that doesn't stop science. It just means you have to bring mind into it. And we need to be very careful about this. But I agree with you about BOMA as well. Stephen Jay Gould, I love reading, but I think he was wrong about NOMA. Non-overlapping magisteria sounds great until you see that science deals with reality and religion deals with Santa Claus, which is the subtext of this. Partially overlapping magisteria, certainly. The Bible is not a textbook of science. I don't teach algebra out of Leviticus, and never will. But when it states, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, it's talking about the same heavens and earth that physicists and astrophysicists are talking about. So there is overlap, and that overlap is highly significant. It's not huge, but there's a statement about creation followed by a sequence, and God said, and God said, which is summed up in the New Testament, in the beginning was the Word. This is a text-based universe that comes from intelligence. I think those are very profound indicators. But I agree with you, we must keep, science generally asks the how questions or the why questions of function. It doesn't ask the bigger questions of purpose. So I think there's a large degree of agreement there. Gould went too far. But I'm worried about the definition of science. I'm happy with somebody say science is a materialistic endeavor. And you said it very carefully, and I agree with you. But then don't come along and say it shuts out God. If you invent a machine that can only see visible light, and my name is Röntgen, and I come along from Würzburg and say, I've discovered X-rays, and you point your machine at them and say, they don't exist, I don't see them. I said, but you've designed your machine not to see them. If we got that picture, it's okay. But the problem today is that people think if it doesn't come within a naturalistic scientific paradigm, it can't be true, and secondly, it can't be rational, because science and rationality are made equivalent. So there's a large measure of parallel thinking there.
Well, you brought up Genesis, and which kind of brings us a little bit to the topic of discussion, does God care about the earth? And I would argue, based on Genesis, that he does, because every verse of Genesis, or practically every verse, he says, and he saw that it was good. He did this, and he saw that it was good. He did that, and created that, and he saw that it was good. And he finishes up, and he says, he saw that it was very good. So whether you believe God created the heavens and the earth, or whether you believe it was the Big Bang, and the formation of stars and nebulas that collapsed, and planetesimals that collided with one another, and an earth that accreted. Either way, God, it was good. God saw that it was good. So that would imply to me that from a Christian point of view, creation is worth saving, creation is worth protecting. From a non-Christian point of view, from an atheistic or an agnostic point of view, it's worth protecting as well, because it's our lifeboat. It's where we live. If we value humans, if we value life, then it's worth protecting.
To follow up on that, and we obviously are wanting to deal with the value of the planet, caring for the planet, a related question is, what is the basis of the moral imperative, and whether the validity of objective values depends upon the existence of God, or is it possible to say that there's a moral imperative that's binding on everyone, regardless of whether God exists. And why not? So is it possible to have a moral imperative without God in the picture, is the question.
Well, I think it is. So the Bible says love your neighbor. You know, that is the best practice for behavior. That comes from the Bible, but it also comes from humanism. You don't need the Bible to tell you that. As Thomas Jefferson would say, we hold this truth to be self-evident. In cruder terms, it's a no-brainer. It goes without saying. There's a lot of ways to express that. But it's pretty easy to argue that the love your neighbor and what follows the golden rule and basically all the commandments that are important follow from that one rule, and caring for the planet is a direct consequence of that tenet.
Genesis, I agree with you entirely, Mark, that it is a mandate for being a steward of creation. That's the word I like most. And one of my friends was chairman of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and he's written a book on this. It's very warm, if you like, in putting this forward, that God saw it was good and so on. He cares for it, so you ought to care for it. And your second point is equally important. Let me see, can I tease it out a little bit as I see it? You made the point we don't need the Bible to tell us to love our neighbor, because you get the golden rule in every other religion, philosophy, including the Humanist Manifesto. That's absolutely right. Lewis pointed that out in 1940 in the back of a book which I believe everybody should read, called The Abolition of Man. And he pointed out that that's exactly what you would expect if the Bible were right, that human beings are created as moral beings in the image of God, so that whether they believe in God or not, they've got these moral principles and they can come up with a moral imperative. That doesn't quite deal with the question of whether there is a God or not. Now, I want to go, as you will expect, a little bit further than that. I agree with you entirely. I'd go even further in this sense. My atheist friends can put me to shame morally. There's no privileged position for being a Christian. In fact, Christians claim to be people who've recognized that they're not even living up to their own standards of morality and need redemption. They're not putting themselves above others, and we should respect the moral imperative wherever we see it. So I'm with you absolutely there, but let's take the next step down. I spent a lot of time in Russia, and for them, Dostoevsky was always a kind of prophet. And he made the famous statement, if God does not exist, everything is permissible. He did not mean that atheists can't behave morally. That's nonsense. What he meant is that rationally, you've got a real problem of getting a moral imperative out of the isness of creation. Now, I was interested in you quoting Thomas Jefferson, because I was just reading him the other day, and here's what he said. God, who gave us life, gave us liberty. And can the liberties of a nation be thought secure when we have removed their only firm basis, a conviction in the minds of the people that these liberties are of the gift of God? That's very interesting coming from him, as you know, for his other philosophies. But that recognition goes very deep. Charles Taylor is one of the world experts on secularism, and he picks up on nature, really, and says the modern age, more or less repudiating the idea of a divine lawgiver, has nevertheless tried to retain the ideas of moral right and wrong, not noticing that in casting God aside, they have also abolished the conditions of meaningfulness for moral right and wrong as well. Educated people, says Taylor, do not need to be told, however, that questions such as these have never been answered outside religion. And one incident I remember in Siberia, a Russian academician, and we were talking about these things, and he says, you know, Dostoevsky was such a prophet. I said, how? Well, he said, we thought we could get rid of God and retain a value for human beings. We found out too late that that's impossible. Now Nietzsche, he saw that. He said, look, you people that feel that you can retain, in contemporary words, a contemporary modern Western liberal philosophy and morality and get rid of God, are kidding yourselves, it's impossible. Now Dawkins, interestingly, goes as near as possible to the edge of that volcano when he says, this universe is exactly like you'd expect it to be if, at bottom, there is no good, no evil, and no justice. DNA just is, and we dance to its music. So that the terrorists who are destroying both the Earth and its artifacts and people are just dancing to the music of their DNA. That's the end of all morality. And that's where my major problem comes. And as you probably know, it goes back to David Hume, that it is very difficult to argue from just the sheer isness of the life to what I ought to do. It works brilliantly when you've got little islands of almost equal power. You're an island, and I'm an island. And I say, I'm going to do this, and you say, you're not, because we'll gang up and stop you. But suppose I get all the power, and you say, you ought to do that, and I say, ought? Why ought I? And if you've got nothing higher to refer to, you're really stuck, and that's where we are in the world today, of course. There's a huge moral confusion, because we've, for the first, really, century in history, in the West, we've got rid of a vertical dimension of morality, and we've made it all horizontal, and we don't know where to put the parameters of it. So that's how I'd respond to that, having a great deal of sympathy with what you're saying, because I really do believe my atheist friends and skeptical friends and agnostic friends care for the planet sometimes more than I do. Of course, we have different jobs, but the mandate comes from Genesis, and that's not a reason for not believing in God. Because God can, belief in God can wind that up and of course make it much stronger. If this has got to do with the basic principles of the universe created by God, that's going to help your cause.
So you quoted Thomas Jefferson referring to God, and he did in a lot of his writings.
Yes.
He had a very different view of God and people refer to him as a deist. Which my understanding means the God he believed in was the God who created the universe and then let it go and did not interfere with it. I don't have a problem at all with that kind of a God, because now we know the universe started with the Big Bang, and we don't know what started the Big Bang. And there are a lot of ideas. Now there's this idea of multiverses. Mm-hmm. Where you've got an infinite number of universes, each one with its own set of physical constants, its own gravitational constant, if it has gravity, it may have other forces, its own strong force, its own weak force, and so on. And in only some subset of those universes can life evolve, can planets, can stars form, planets form, life evolve, carbon atoms that allow DNA to replicate. We happen to be in one of those. So then we look at our universe and say, well, this universe must have been created by a God to have so finely, perfectly tuned everything for life. But that's the only universe that we can be in. So there's something called the anthropic principle that says you can only observe what's observable. Now, I look at both of those ideas, how the Big Bang started. You know, you've got an idea of God, or you've got an idea of multiverses. And in a way, they're equally scientific or unscientific. That's within that, I think you said partially overlapping, POMA. That's in that narrow boundary. It's like, well, okay, that's maybe where we should have the demilitarized zone. Each one of those is equally good or equally bad. I happen to find the multiverse idea a little more appealing because it seems naturalistic to me, but in a sense, it's not observable, even in principle. It can't be proven or disproven, so it's more like God.
That makes it less like golf. May I say something about this? You see, what's at the back of this is a set of false alternatives. You started off by saying God created or there's a Big Bang. But the Big Bang is simply saying there was a beginning. Genesis is spelling it out that the cause of that beginning is an intelligent God. There's absolutely no conflict there whatsoever. We're having two different descriptions of exactly the same thing. That's point number one. Point number two, the multiverse theory has a very interesting provenance. Max Tegmark at Princeton said there's either a multiverse or there's a creator. What was that a reaction to? The fine-tuning. But he got it wrong, because if there is a God, he can create as many universes as he likes. The existence, and I say that advisedly, one of Stephen Hawking's collaborators is the physicist Don Page in Canada, and Don wrote 8 or 9 papers with him. And when I wrote my book, God and Stephen Hawking, on this very thing, I wrote to Don. Now, Don is a Christian, believes in the multiverse. And he says there's absolutely no conflict in his mind between the two. So we mustn't use multiverse versus God. Secondly, I feel that your idea, and it's true, I was taught quantum mechanics by John Polkinghorne, and I ought to admit that because he's allergic to the multiverse. And so is Roger Penrose, increasingly, because he says it's, well, I quote, it's what you say when you haven't got a theory. It's an excuse for a theory. So the audience need to understand that there's a huge amount of debate for the reason that you gave. There's no accessibility. But I believe there's every accessibility to God, and there's every evidence for his existence. And that's why I would massively prefer, but not prefer, preference is an emotional term. I believe in a God. There may or may not be a multiplicity of universes. In fact, the Bible hints that this may not be the only one. So it's not even a difficulty. But the evidence that there is a God, the kind that I've already mentioned, and a whole lot more, because a lot of my evidence for the existence of God comes from my Christianity, not simply from my theism, that God has revealed himself. So I wouldn't put them in the same category intellectually at all, although I'm very interested in the ways people try to avoid believing in a creator.
Let me push a little further on the question of the basis for morality. And we certainly hear in our day, as has been touted in previous eras, some who are arguing for a scientifically grounded morality. Sam Harris is one recently who's espoused that. And is it the case that science has the capability of revealing to us not just what is, but how we ought to live? Is that a viable option?
Well, I would say science can inform that question. Science can answer that question. Science can't tell us what is moral and what's not moral. Science can give us clues to why we have the morality we do. And I think there's all sorts of lines of scientific investigation that might inform morality. For example, animal behaviorists that study these two different ape species, chimpanzees and bonobos. They're virtually identical in terms of DNA. Of course, they're virtually identical to us in terms of DNA too, which informs it maybe even a little bit more. But these two species have different geographic areas. They split a couple million years ago on two sides of the Zaire River. The chimpanzees have a very, very different strategy for survival and social cohesion than the bonobos do, even though they're essentially almost the same species. They diverged. And you know, you can think of the behavior that evolved as being kind of like their morality. The chimpanzees are male dominant. They're violent, they can commit infanticide, and the females hunt and gather by themselves. The bonobos, on the other hand, have some kind of gender equity. They're sexually promiscuous. They never commit infanticide because they're sexually promiscuous. They don't know whose kids are whose. So, okay, which, you know, so they kind of have their own morality that keeps their social structures and their genes going. So the genes that lead to these behaviors, the chimpanzee males probably have a lot more testosterone, for example. So how does that relate to humans? That suggests that human behavior is an evolutionary trait. And a lot of behavior that we consider moral, that the majority of humans consider moral, like love your neighbor, is actually what allowed our species to continue to not go extinct. Those genes survived, those genes that led to that morality. Now, is that fundamentally moral? That's another question. That's a completely different question. There's another field, cooperation theory. It's basically an agent-based computing method where you play these cooperation games. There's something called the prisoner's dilemma, where two competitors can either decide to cooperate or one of them can decide to defect, cheat. The prisoner's dilemma actually comes from a game theory. Suppose you've got two gang members, they're arrested, they're put in solitary confinement where they can't communicate with one another, and they're interrogated, and they get sentences depending on the outcome, and they can either cooperate with one another without knowing the other one is willing to cooperate. If they cooperate and don't rat each other out, they each get 1 year. If one of them cooperates and the other one rats out, the one that cooperated gets 3 years, the one that rats the other guy out gets out of prison. And so, you know, there's a gain. The global gain is best if they cooperate. That minimizes their loss. So you can play this repeatedly, and it turns out that the best strategy is called tit for tat. If your opponent rats you out, then you rat him out next time, and then you forgive, and then you go on. And so there's a quick tit for tat, and that's it. There's a punishment. The punishment matches the crime. Of course, that comes straight from the Bible, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. So that's an optimal behavior for a computer. So that's kind of computer morality. But as it turns out, humans aren't so clean. I mean, you might actually think the other guy defected, and then you defect, and then he tit for tat you, and then you go back and forth, and throughout this misunderstanding, you get a big escalation. And I think that's why Jesus said, turn the other cheek. That might be tit for two tats, you know, which is actually a strategy that's been fairly successful in these cooperation theory models. So, to answer the question, can science address the question of morality? I think science can inform morality. What is the sort of social behavioral advantages of being moral? But it can't tell you what is moral.
Well, Einstein made that point a long time ago. You can talk about the ethical foundations of science, but you can't talk about the scientific foundations of ethics. And I think most thinkers have realized that what you say is perfectly right, that chemistry can tell you that if you give your granny strychnine, it'll give her a very rough time. But it can't tell you whether you ought to do that in order to get your hands on her property. And Sam Harris, I think you must be referring to the book The Moral Landscape, where he claims to have solved Hume's problem, which I mentioned earlier, but not explicitly. The basic idea is this. Now, David Hume was a Scottish Enlightenment philosopher with whom I disagree about a lot of things, but I don't disagree with him here. He writes in one of his famous books about observing that people will describe a situation and is, this was like that and like that, and then suddenly they slip into writing, and so you ought, and it changes from is to ought. He said you cannot move from is to ought. And Jacques Monod, the Nobel Prize winning chemist, said, you know, all philosophies since the word go have been attempts really to get from is to ought, and they all fail. And I think, in fact, I delayed the publication of my book Gunning for God when Sam Harris's book came out, because I suspected that he was claiming to have got through this barrier and failing. And how he fails, I can't go into the details, but I do in my book, is that he smuggles the ought into the original proposition. And of course, if you smuggle the moral bit in to start with, then of course you can get an ought out of is if the is includes the ought. Now, we'll not waste any more time on that. I think this is a huge barrier, actually. It's parallel in my mind to getting rationality out of irrationality. And it's very interesting to observe animals. This is the cause of a huge problem, not the solution to it. Because if you study the animal kingdoms, you can come up with any morality you like. And that's the problem. How do you choose? Darwin, because you mentioned altruism, and he was a kindly man, he studied ants and he saw how they cooperated, and there's a nice basis for cooperation, and so it is. But Spencer saw nature red in tooth and claw and saw the survival of the fittest. That principle has been applied to morality. As we know, at least in my lifetime, it has. And we know with what consequences. The huge problem now is, once we lose the vertical dimension of God, we've only got at most two potential sources for morality, and they're both down here in this earth. And why we're in such confusion in Europe, I needn't talk about North America, is it's almost completely arbitrary. It becomes a matter of what I think and so on, because there's no transcendent reference. And therefore, I think that what is being shown to be true is that Dostoevsky is dead right. But I also agree with you that science can inform us on moral decisions. Take a very controversial one. Science can tell us that a fetus suffers pain much long before a lot of people thought. And so it can inform. Now, I'm not saying, I'm not going to go into that topic where I stand on it. But the fact is that science can inform us that pain is being experienced where it was believed that no pain was happening before. But you're dead right. Science cannot make the moral decisions for us. And Harris is walking into a minefield. Unfortunately, Richard Dawkins, when the book was launched in Oxford some time ago, he thought Harris had solved the problem. But Harris has not solved the problem. And I might just add that one of the ways in which people like John Rawls, the leading philosopher, solves it. He says, look, if you want to catch the bus at 20 past 8, you ought to leave now. There you are. The is situation is the bus is leaving at 20 past 8. The ought is you ought to leave now. That is a very simplistic philosophical mistake that fails to recognize that in English the word ought has two meanings. That's the ought of prudence. You don't have a moral obligation to catch that bus. You might just rather hear the two of us or the three of us discussing these things. And that's such a simplistic, but many people try to solve it that way. I don't think it's solvable. And I think J.L. Mackey was right when he says we all believe in absolute values. I don't think there'd be anyone in this room that thinks that torturing babies is right in any circumstances. So we believe in absolute values. Mackey was an atheist philosopher, and he says there's a very short path from the existence of absolute values and God.
In just a few minutes, we're going to be turning over to taking questions from the audience, but if you haven't submitted your question, do so right away. Let me ask a more practical question. If we have different bases from which people derive their values, if one ends up caring for the planet, does environmental concern look different if it proceeds from a theistic basis or a secular basis, or is that inconsequential?
I think it doesn't make a difference where you get your morality. I think the Bible very clearly says, love your neighbor. Jesus taught the golden rule. And Jefferson, he called himself a Christian. In fact, he called himself a real Christian, underlined in a letter, because he said he's a disciple of the doctrines of Jesus. But he went on to cut all the supernatural parts out of his version of the Bible. And he created a Bible, and I have a copy of it here. It's called the Jefferson Bible. He called it the Life and Morals of Jesus of Nazareth. Not God-given, but given by Jesus the man. I got it at the Jefferson Memorial for $18. They have the original at the original Jefferson Bible at the Smithsonian Museum of American History. So even though you quoted him referring to God, that these unalienable rights are given by our Creator, he said, it goes without saying, we hold these truths to be self-evident. Okay, so I don't think you have to believe in God to understand that that is the basis for our morality, and everything follows from that. You don't need the entire Bible to tell you how to behave. I mean, I look at the Bible as being more like book on electricity and magnetism. You know, everything condenses to Maxwell's equations, and now you can have lots and lots and lots of examples of their application. That's what the Bible is about. So the fundamental, and even the Bible says that. And I've never read scripture before a group before, but I did write some things down. You shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in the word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. That's Romans 13:9. So, and it says it in more than one place in the Bible. You don't need it. But I think that may have overgeneralized, because love your neighbor as yourself doesn't say anything about remembering the Sabbath and keeping it holy, I don't think. And I would guess that not everybody here does that, even the devout Christians.
Well, the Sabbath never was a moral commandment. That's why it's different from the others. But to come to the points you're making, that the first commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your mind, soul, and strength. And I see the problem as essentially this. It is wonderful to have a moral imperative to look after the planet and to do so. And I admire people of all faiths, religions, and everybody else who try to rein in our consumption rates, our greed, and all that kind of thing. I'm entirely with you there. I regard what we do with our bodies, which are part of the physical universe, and our minds as part of that stewardship. And you see, getting rid of the supernatural from Christianity, to my mind, eviscerates it completely. How do you take seriously the morality of a man who claimed to be God and who claimed to come to die for people's sins and rise again? You see, for me, Mark, Christ came into this world and he made a very interesting claim. He called himself Lord, in Greek kurios, and it means the owner. I believe the owner is going to return. And I've no doubt he'll be very interested in how I stewarded the planet. But I think he'd be much more interested in my relationship with him. Because what is being offered in Christianity is not merely a motivation for a moral imperative. It is a vastly bigger thing. It is the enjoyment, and I've enjoyed it for over 60 years, the enjoyment of a personal relationship with the God who invented the atom, the stars, your mind, and everything else. The God who painted all the colors into the rainbow. The God who gave us relationships and families and love and aesthetic senses and so on, and gave some of us the opportunity to develop those things. We're going to meet him again. Now, it's very interesting. I'm very much with you on the biblical view of the planet. Many people have never read the statement in the book of Revelation that goes like this: the time has come for the judgment of the dead and to destroy those who destroy the earth. That's how much God cares for the planet. But I am going to, I believe, and that's where my huge problem with atheism and Dawkins comes. There's no good, there's no evil, there's no justice. If there's no life after death, then in the end, the vast majority who've ever lived on this planet will not get justice, because they won't get it in this life, and there's no other life to get it in. I believe there is going to be justice, and that fact that it's a divine justice ought to make me very careful how I treat you and how I treat the environment. But without that, then morality just evanesces into what we prefer or what the given social mores of the day. So at stake for me is the biggest thing in all of the universe for me, and that is the marvelous gift that God's prepared to give anyone who trusts Christ, and that's a huge thing that we could go into, but of a relationship with him that pours meaning into life. Because you know from your physics that this earth is a temporary phenomenon. From the biblical perspective, there is going to be a new heavens and a new earth. God loves physics and chemistry. He's not finished with material. That was bad Greek philosophy that finished with material. So that's where I stand on this. It's the big story into which life can fit. Care for the environment is part of it. But that raises the question, is there an owner? And what are we going to say to him when he comes back and says, you were interested in this planet, what about me? What about me?
Show our appreciation.
First of all, that was very enlightening. I feel smarter already. That was serious. A clarification I do want to make, and one of you in the audience pointed this out, so thank you to that. But they just wanted to draw attention to the fact that Anthony Flew, who was identified as a skeptic earlier tonight, changed his position in 2004 and wrote the book, There Is a God, How the World's Most Notorious Atheist Changed His Mind. You probably get that at a bookstore somewhere. Keep bookstores, yay. I'm in the English department. all right, so I just wanted to mention too at the beginning that we were flooded with questions. So if you do not have your question answered, I'm so sorry. But we have tried to pick some of the most common questions that came through and the ones that were the most pertinent to our discussion that we've had here. So the first question, and this is to you, Dr. Lennox, how did you choose Christianity compared to any other interpretation of God? And would a firsthand experience of the fulfillment of a prophecy from a text other than the New Testament cause you to change your religious views? And if so, how?
Is that all?
Five more clauses coming. Yes, that's it.
Let me say first that I knew the late Anthony Flew. He never ceased to be a skeptic, but he came to believe in God. You see, there's a confusion in this, and we ought to realize this. I'm a skeptic, just as Mark is. We check things out from a distance. Unfortunately now, people come along and say, I'm a skeptic, which means I'm an atheist, but that doesn't follow. I did discuss this with Anthony Flew. The interesting thing about him, and I must tell you this is, he came to believe in a kind of deistic God. Why? On the basis of the information content of DNA. And that's why that book is a very interesting read. Now, you've asked me a question that in one sense is not relevant to our topic tonight. It's a personal question, so if you allow me a personal answer, I'll give it. Do you want me to answer it? You do? Oh, that's all right then. We all start somewhere. No one starts in a vacuum intellectually. And the first religion in that sense that I came across was Christianity. And that stuck, not because it was where I started, but because of that thing that I told you that I set about in Cambridge, to spend my life opening my faith in God to all kinds of inspection and so on. And therefore, I've had to choose. I've got friends in all religions. But let me just give you a simple, very direct answer to this question. And it's this. Central to my faith is the claim that Jesus was the Son of God. Major evidence for it, the historical fact of the resurrection. I wouldn't sit here for a millisecond claiming to be a Christian if I didn't believe that happened as a fact of history. Now, my many Jewish friends tell me that Jesus died and did not rise. My many Muslim friends tell me that Jesus did not die. I claim he died and rose. Those views are mutually exclusive. How can you decide an answer to them? I only know of one way. Where does the evidence point? Where does the best evidence point? That's the short answer to the question. The secondary answer to the question is possibly more important. We've discussed morality, and Marx made the point, and I reinforce it, that you find essentially the same basic morality in every philosophy and religion, or lack of it. The thing that differentiates Christianity is not in its morality. It's in the question that any morality raises, if there is a God. I don't keep those standards that you read out from Scripture. I don't even keep my own standards. If there is a holy God, how am I going to relate to him? Now, if you look at religion as a subject, so to speak, I talk to many people and say, tell me about your religion. And what they say is, it's like the University of New Mexico. By which they mean there's an entrance test or something, some ceremony you go through and you're in. You then are taught by various professors, you're on the way, and it goes up and down. But then there's an awful thing that happens in the end called final examinations. Now, the professors might be marvelous people like these two, but they cannot guarantee that you get a degree, isn't that right? Why is that? Because the basic principle is merit. Now, the vast majority of people, even professing Christians, think that that's what religion is. You've got some sort of ceremony possibly performed on you as a child, you're taught, you try and keep on the way, and you hope in the end that when the great assessment comes, God will evaluate your life as the good tipping the ill. Now, Christianity at this level does not compete with any other religion. Let me emphasize that. It's not in competition with any of them, because it offers me something none of them offer me. And that is a forgiveness that doesn't occur at the end, but at the beginning. And this is a staggering nature of it. It's why I'm a Christian, actually. That Christ said, and we have to ask, is it true or not? But he said, there's a huge problem between me and God. I've made a mess of my life and possibly of other people's lives and the environment. How can I relate to a God who's holy? And Christ says, you cannot work it out from yourself. So what I've come to do is to do something on the basis of which you can be accepted. And you can know it. And that is so huge. Many people don't realize it. They think that we slavishly try and earn merit with God in the hope that one day he's accepted us. My final point is that is this. We never treat a fellow human being that way. I met a girl first day in Cambridge. She was only 16, but she was beautiful. And I decided that I'd like to marry her. So I came to her and I got a cookbook. And I showed her this cookbook and I said, you see these laws here, there are lots of these laws. Now, I'd like you to be my wife. And the condition is this, that you keep these rules for the next 30 or 40 years and keep me, and then I'll accept you. Can you imagine what she would have done? And yet millions of people, ladies and gentlemen, think that is the way to be related to God. We would never insult a fellow human being by making our acceptance of them conditional. And God does this magnificent thing. Christ does the work on the cross. Now, whether we understand it or not, it's worth listening to what actually is involved here. And because, not because I'm better than anybody else, precisely the opposite. Because I trusted him many years ago with the weight of that. I know I'm going to be with him. Not because I'm good, but because he has given me that forgiveness and pardon. And you know, we haven't mentioned it tonight, but guilt, forgiveness, and that kind of thing are huge elements in students' lives today. I'd love to have another hour to talk about them. But that's basically my answer to that question.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Lennox. Dr. Boslough, this one's for you. Without immediate ramifications for the here and now, what motivations do we have to attempt to keep the planet better than we found it?
Well, from my own morality, it's just the way you treat people. You don't take something from someone. You don't take the environmental services from someone without some compensation. And I think that's just another way of saying, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. So we think of future generations. We need to pay forward what we got. And we brought up Thomas Jefferson, the founding fathers of our country. They sacrificed a lot. They wrote the Constitution to protect our rights. They wrote it with the intent of having it go down many, many generations, and it has. And that's part of the reason that we have such good lives. And so I don't see any problem whatsoever sacrificing a little bit of our lifestyle so that we can pass a better planet to the future than the one that, we got from our ancestors.
Thank you. Dr. Lennox, it's back to you. Why does our semiotic connection to the universe through mathematics, language, physics, etc., have to be divine in nature? What of that connection connotes evidence for God?
They don't have to be divine. I'm fairly careful, not always in my language, being an Irishman. The point is, we're asking the question, what evidences have we got? Now, the evidence of the mathematical describability of the universe, that was the fundamental belief of the pioneering scientists, all of whom were believers in God. Galileo, Kepler, Newton, Clark Maxwell, and so on. And there's a strong connection with this. It's not that I'm talking about proof. Proof only occurs in pure mathematics, and that's my field, in the strict sense. But in the ordinary use of language, proof is evidence, pointers. And they can be very powerful. I trusted myself to a Boeing aircraft to get me to North America. I couldn't prove it would get me here, but I staked my life on it. And it's very important to realize that. You can't get proof here. And what I'm saying is language, its existence, especially when you find it naturally, as in DNA, it resonates with the biblical claim, in the beginning was the Word was God, and God said. That is, the creation involved natural processes, of course, but it involved God speaking a text. That makes sense. Now you can say, of course, it doesn't have to be God. It could be some alien intelligence. Well, it could, but what alien intelligence? Have we any more evidence? And the point I would make to that is we have far more evidence of God. So it's a very simple, it's not a sophisticated thing, this is. It's the conclusion we draw the moment we see Veritas. We don't know how that was printed by automatic machinery, but we know somewhere along the line a mind was involved. The second answer to your question, because I'm not finished, you see, is that there's a danger in basing the whole discussion on the idea that we're searching for evidences of God. It could be that God is searching for us as well. And you see, the central Christian claim is not that we get a lot of knowledge of God about the creation. We don't. And the Bible admits it. What Paul says is from creation you can deduce that there is a God, Theotokos, that there is a God and that he's powerful. But beyond that you don't go. The central Christian message is that God became human. The Word became flesh, and we beheld his glory. So if you want to know about the nature of God, we being made in his image, now this is crucially important, although it's staggering in its implications. What does it mean to be a human being? What's special about humans? The most special thing about you and me is that we're members of a species that God could become one of. That is staggering. The Word became flesh. And I hold that as a scientist and a Christian. So I believe that God is searching for us. It's not that we work out and try and solve it all through science. It's very limited. But because I'm open, I'm prepared to consider, well, if there is a God, it's highly likely that he has revealed himself to us. Now, that doesn't oppose our reason, as Richard Dawkins thinks. Richard Dawkins says, we believe in reason, we don't believe in holy books. Whoever could read a holy book without the reason, I just don't know. I mean, that's just silly talk. The point is that there are more sources of information than our exploration of the physical world. You see, if you wanted to get to know me, you could analyze me scientifically and do all sorts of CT scans. You'd never get to know me. The only way you will get to know me is if I reveal myself to you by speaking only. Once I speak, you use your reason to see if it makes sense. But your reason alone will never produce anything out of me. It's exactly the same. God has revealed himself. So we've now got a vast new source of information on which we can work. The final point, of course, is the testability of Christianity. It actually works. But that's possibly a subject for a bit later. If there is a bit later. I'll stop.
Dr. Boslough, this one is for you. Prepare yourself, it's a little bit long. Okay. So it says, I'm a Christian and a graduate philosophy student. Given atheism, how is an ought derivable from an is?
Name what?
An ought, A-O-U-G-H-T, okay. Derivable from an is. Namely, what ontological reference point is there within a material universe to ground objective moral values? And if not, then why should we care about subjective moral imperatives that aren't really imperatives at all?
Wow. I'm not sure I entirely understand that. So I'm a scientist, I'm not a philosopher. I guess I'll fall back on this. We hold these truths to be self-evident. There's certain things, for example, in mathematics, John's topic, you start with an axiom. And everything else is derivable in a mathematics. For example, now correct me if I'm wrong, A plus B is equal to B plus A. Is that an axiom or is that derived?
It depends what sort of algebra.
Okay. So I would argue that you can start with an axiom like love your neighbor as yourself and derive a whole lot of rules based on that and rules to live by. Now, I don't know. I have no idea if that answers the question.
Well, I think you have a pretty good answer. I didn't even know what to sing, so.
I don't think it answers the question for a very simple reason. We hold these truths as self-evident. Why? What is it that makes them self-evident?
Our intelligence, our reason.
Yes, but where does it come from? The reason we hold them as self-evident is we're made in the image of God. We're moral beings to start with, you see. And I think the questioner is dead right. There is no way of getting from is to ought. You can't ground a moral imperative in material. Now, your attitude is dead on. I agree with you. You start with love your neighbor as yourself. You grant the moral imperative. You don't raise the question where it comes from.
Right.
I want to be awkward. I want to raise the question where it comes from.
Is there more to say on that one? Your guys' guess is better than mine. Great. Dr. Lennox, this is for you. This is from an audience member. As someone who has studied philosophy and also as a Christian, do you reject or accept the nature of Kant's categorical imperative as a realistic explanation for explaining our motives? Do you consider it to be Christian in nature?
This is really a question for ethics 101, isn't it? And how many of you know what Kant's categorical imperative is? Well, if we go by a majority vote, I shouldn't say any more. But I'll say something very, very briefly. One of the problems, I think, in evaluating many ethical systems like virtue ethics, like Kant's imperative, like Christian divine command theory and so on, is people, when they first encounter them, think that they're mutually exclusive. And that's a profound mistake. Take the most common ethical system in the world today, utilitarianism or preference utilitarianism. Peter Singer is the great guru, and I've debated him on this. Now, utilitarianism says the basic principle is that it's deliberately designed to do away with God. the maximum benefit for the maximum number of people. So do I reject utilitarianism? Yes and no. If I'm dividing ice cream among 10 children and I don't do it on a utilitarian basis, I'll be shot. You have to give the maximum benefit to the maximum number of people. In other words, you give them what's exactly equal. But you come to the other side and say, Hitler took the view that the maximum benefit for the maximum number of people was to eliminate the Poles and the Jews. What about that? Kant's categorical imperative is you must act on a principle that you could universally apply, not only to yourself. There's a lot of Christian sense in that. And Kant, you see, was not an atheist, as many people say. The starry heavens above him and the moral law within is what's written on his tombstone. He wrote the Critique of Pure Reason, talking about how you can't get to God by pure reason, but practical reason is a very different thing. Christians need to learn to evaluate these things, because the moral philosophies were thought up, from my perspective, by people made in the image of God, whether they believed it or not, and therefore they talk a lot of sense, you see. And that's why we can all agree in this room, and it's amazing how all religions agree on the golden rule. We are moral beings, so we can start somewhere. Otherwise, society would fall completely apart. But the self-evidence of these truths and the fact that we're moral beings, I'm curious enough to want to know an answer there. And what connects the dots for me and gives me the big picture is that there's a God who is a person and who himself is the embodiment of good, and therefore we relate to him. So you can't get away from God.
Dr. Boslough, this one's for you. It's a little bit more straightforward, so we're lucky. What are a few steps you would suggest we take to become more environmentally responsible?
Oh boy, that's a good question. And it's always hard to bring up this issue of global warming, and if we continue on the path, it's just going to get worse and worse. It's hard to talk about that without giving solutions, and there are solutions, and I think really there's three things. One is adaptation. I mean, we are already on the path. It's going to continue. Even if we stopped producing CO2 right now, there is something, what my colleagues call, there's still heat in the pipeline. We haven't gotten to equilibrium yet. So the Earth will continue to keep getting warmer. Sea level will continue to rise, even if we stop right now. So adaptation is something that we should be already doing. The second part is mitigation. Mitigation is reducing our carbon footprint. There's a lot we can do individually to do that. We can use cars that have better mileage. We can take public transportation. We can turn off lights that we're not using. Very, very simple things like that. Lead a simpler life. Buy locally grown food. That sort of thing. But I think the third thing is the most important, and that is collective action. We need to make it clear to our politicians, to our representatives, that we think this is a problem, and we need to implement policies that actually reduce our collective carbon footprint. And there's all sorts of different kinds of policies, subsidies for renewables, removing subsidies, and especially hidden subsidies for fossil fuels. One way to do that is to implement some kind of carbon dumping fee. It shouldn't be free to dump waste into the atmosphere that's shared by everyone. And so one of the best proposals I've heard is a carbon dumping fee with a 100% rebate. So basically you take the big people with the big carbon footprints and the industries with the big carbon footprints, they have to pay so much money for every ton of CO2 they emit into our atmosphere, into the common atmosphere, and then that gets split up into equal shares and paid to people. What that does is it offsets the cost of the increase in carbon for ordinary people. People with really, really carbon-intensive lifestyles, they come out behind. Super wealthy people that take advantage of cheap carbon, they come out behind. Ordinary people, and especially lower income people, they come out ahead. So that's one way to fix the problem. Basically, that leads to an infrastructure that is more efficient and lower in the average carbon footprint will go down just through market forces.
I think we've got time for one more question.
Great. I have one more question to ask, but it's two audience questions put together, so maybe this is cheating. Dr. Lennox, how do you solve the problem of evil? And not a loaded question at all.
I didn't get that one.
There's a second part to it. How do you solve the problem of evil? And if God is benevolent, why do the innocent suffer, i.e. babies and children do die of cancer and a myriad of other terrible diseases? We thought we'd go out with a bang.
That, of course, is the hardest question. It has to do with our topic. As Mark has pointed out, we are making a spectacular mess of this planet. And human greed can lead to deforestation, can lead to starvation. And the problem of evil and suffering, there are two problems. There's the bad things bad people do to others. And then there's the tsunamis, earthquakes, cancers, and so on. And we all face it. You face it, I face it. And if we don't have anything sensible to say about it, we're in a huge difficulty. Secondly, there are two perspectives. There may be someone in this room who's been told she's got terminal cancer. Her view of that cancer will be very different from the professor of oncology that told her she got it. We watch evil. We experience evil. And so it's got an intellectual side, and it's got a subjective, personal side. And you need to address both. I'm going to be very short, because this is a huge topic. If you want to know what I really think about it, just Google Veritas and my name. Because it's the most asked after topic in North America, by far. The intellectual side, I can sympathize. I have many friends who are atheists because of Auschwitz, for instance. And I've been to Auschwitz many times, and I've wept every time. What do you say? And they say, well, that's the end of God. You can't, possibly believe in God. So I say, okay. You've got rid of God, and that seems to have solved the problem. But what problem has it solved? The suffering's still there. What you have got rid of, utterly and completely, is hope. Because those people who'd suffered, and I said earlier this evening, the vast majority of people are not living like you and me. The amount of human suffering of the billions who've ever lived, there's no redress if death is the end, if atheism is true. So they haven't solved anything, really. Now, as a Christian, of course, I have a problem. And I spent many a night as a student asking your question, if there's a good God and he's all-powerful, you know all the arguments. Have you ever got to a satisfactory conclusion with those arguments? No. Now, I'm a mathematician, and we're taught that if you can't answer one question, you should think of a different question to ask. And that's actually very important. The reason we get no satisfaction in answering that question is when all the arguments has been done, we're faced with what I call beauty and barbed wire. Look at the mountains here, and the skies above New Mexico, beautiful, that's beauty. An act of love or kindness is beautiful. Barbed wire, ISIS, blood flowing. That's our world. It presents us with a mixed picture. So whatever your answer is, it's got to face the fact that reality is a mixed picture, isn't it? Now, here's my alternative question. Granted that life is like that, whether we like it or not, the question I ask is a very hard one. Is there anywhere any evidence that there exists a God that you could trust with that? That's a big question, ladies and gentlemen. And I believe there is two things about it. It's a huge thing. Center of Christianity is a cross. Now, the claim is that the one on the cross was God incarnate. Now, if you think that's nonsense, just try and follow the logic before you reject it. If that is God on a cross, it tells me one thing straight away, that God has not remained distant from human suffering, but has himself become part of it. That's a big thing. But the second thing's even bigger. The claim is that Jesus rose from the dead, so death isn't the end. And he's going to be the final judge. That's a glorious thing to know. If there is no final assessment, Hitler gets away with it, ISIL gets away with it, the terrorists get away with it, the rapists get away with it. And our human conscience screams at us that that cannot be true. The biblical claim is that justice will be done and seen to be done. And it'll be done by a man. The sinning, the evil has been done by human beings. Now, if we begin to go down that road, I have seen in my life many, many people. It doesn't take away the problem of suffering. But to have a relationship with a God like that opens up the possibility, and I believe the actuality, that whenever I die, sooner or later, whether violently or not, it's going to be the entry into another world. What a tiny world atheism gives you, ladies and gentlemen. 70 years, I've already reached that, more or less, and then that's the end, and there's nothing, no ultimate significance. And when I put this to Richard Dawkins, rather sadly, he said, but I worked for justice in this world. I said, Richard, wonderful, so do I. But on the basis of what you believe, there is no ultimate justice. And that's another reason why I'm a Christian, ladies and gentlemen. Because although it doesn't solve the problem will always be with us while there's pain. It gives me a way in that can change people's hearts and lives. That the God of the Bible is a God who suffered and is a God who understands your pain and your suffering as you sit in this audience tonight. It would be a shame to bypass an opportunity of getting to know and to trust a God like that. If I didn't have that, I just would disappear because life is so, so short. So that's how I would approach that question.
Would you like to make a final closing statement? Is what you want people to take away?
Sure. Yes. So it was really great to have a dialogue, to talk to people who have various different beliefs in a very respectful way, to kind of generate more understanding. As you can tell, I'm not an evangelical Christian, but I am to some degree evangelical about caring for the planet. I would be happy to come to talk to people wherever they are in their churches. I would be happy to visit. In fact, I'm speaking in a church this Sunday in the St. Peter's Evangelical Lutheran Church in Minneapolis, Minnesota. So if any of you happen to be there, you're welcome to come. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, for listening in on our friendly chat. Mark has a message that needs to be heard, you know. I come from the UK, and there are many organizations of all faiths interested in this. And if you're a Christian and want to see and think what Christians are doing about this, just Google the John Ray Initiative. John Ray, R-A-Y. He was a naturalist in England in years gone by. It is very important. But I thank him and the moderator for enabling us to put these things into a bigger context. And this is a university. Isn't that wonderful? It exposes you to ideas coming from different directions. And tonight has given you an opportunity to test some of your ideas. So you may have come here with questions. Maybe we couldn't. But all a Q&A can do is give you impulses. The important thing now is the work that you do in trying to come to a satisfactory answer to the questions that you brought with you. And get to know other people. And the biggest thing for me as a university student was to spend time listening before I talked to people who did not share my belief system. And I still do it. So thank you so much. And thank you, Mr. Moderator, and thank you, Mark, for making it such thank a you, splendid God. Evening. Thank you.
Thank you.
For more information about the Veritas Forum, including additional recordings and a calendar of upcoming events, please visit our website at veritas.org.